So, it's time for another game comparison. Let's do something a little bit new, although I've actually done this a few times before, but it's a comparison of one game, but between two different versions of a game. This is the first of, two game comparisons, and they're both games by Taito. The first game we're going to look at is the New Zealand Story. The New Zealand Story is a Taito arcade game that I first discovered on the Atari ST. When I was a kid, a friend of mine had an Atari ST computer, and he had a few really interesting games on it. Ones that I remember were the Flintstones and Robocop, and the New Zealand Story. And the New Zealand Story is a game that was ported to the NES and to the Commodore 64 and to the Amiga, but also to the SEGA Master System. But that's not the only game we're going to look at. In the next video, I'll be having a look at Rainbow Islands. And Rainbow Islands also is a game from Taito, and the SEGA Master System version is surprisingly good. So, let's have a look at it. So, first up, a little... comparison of the packaging. This is the NES version of the New Zealand Story, with the very classic ocean packaging with the black design that is very similar to their Spectrum games, and some really nice and colorful screenshots and artwork. I really like this design also. And here is the somewhat hard to find SEGA Master System version. The SEGA Master System version was released by TechMagic, which is a company that did not release that many games. But yeah, this one is really quite neat actually. The differences between the two versions is that the the Master System version has really good graphics and a really good visual presentation, but when it comes to the sound, the NES version is definitely better. When it comes to gameplay, there's something odd going on. The NES version is a lot easier than the Master System version, but with Rainbow Islands, the game that we're going to look at in the next video, it's quite the opposite. It is exactly the other way around. The Master System version there is a lot easier than the NES version. So, let's dig into the game and have a play around with it. So, first up is the NES version. This version was made by Software Creations. Ocean Software published this version, licensed from Taito. And Software Creations actually created the port for them. And the music is done by the legendary Tim Follin. Who doesn't know Tim Follin? He is a legend in the chiptune world. He's one of the legendary Commodore 64 music composers, and he's quite a big name in the world of video game music composition. And yeah, he done several things for Software Creations, including Solstice, if I remember correctly. It's also a game Software Creations did. And yeah, the NES version of the New Zealand Story is, I think, quite good. It plays reasonably well. It has good graphics, nice presentation, and of course the music is absolutely stunning. And as you can see, the gameplay is a little bit slower paced than perhaps the arcade version. I'm not really sure if that's due to hardware limitations. Mind that this is played in 50 Hz, because of my recorder and the NES cannot be modded to 60 Hz that easily, because you would have to replace all the chips. So now I have some kind of laser weapon, which is quite powerful. And here you have this really strange lifting platform thing. It's not a balloon, but it's one of those things from the enemies, and there's some kind of lobster, or what is it? Yeah, I think it's a lobster. Really interesting. And those are kind of undescribable creatures, for which I don't really know what they are. So that's the second Kiwi rescued. On to the third stage. This is where it already gets a little bit trickier, because here you have to capture those hovering pods from the enemies. And you have to keep the button pressed in order to fly. If you hold down the button, you will sink to the ground. So doing that whilst shooting can be a little bit tricky. There should also be a secret stage somewhere here. If you keep shooting a bit randomly in this area or in some other areas of the game, you sometimes enter a warp zone. And in the SEGA Master System version, I actually found one of those warp zones, and you will see that later. But the warp zones are quite convenient, as you will be able to skip quite a few things in the game. So our little kiwi friend can also swim, as you can see. I don't know if kiwi birds can swim in real life. I know they can't really fly, because they are actually quite big birds, and just like chicken, they don't really have the ability to fly. So that's rather strange, and kiwi birds are actually quite well delicate creatures. I've heard that in New Zealand they have a breeding program for kiwis, because they have become quite a rare species, and when they are born in the wild, they most of them don't survive the first year, because there are some natural predators who who like to feast on the kiwi chicks. So they have a breeding program so that in the first year the kiwi birds are being brought up in captivity. And when they're old enough, they are being set out in the wild so that they can fend for themselves. But really young kiwi birds cannot fend for themselves, and a lot of them would be eaten by predators. And that's why it's such a rare species of birds. So another really odd thing about kiwis is that they are not yellow. In this game they are yellow, but in real life they are sort of brown, and they also don't really look like the kiwi in this game. In reality they kind of have a really sharp, pointy beak. It's not really a beak, but it's really long and sharp, and it's so different. In this game it just looks like a duckling, or like a chicklet from a chicken, but that's not how a kiwi looks like. Of course, I know that's nitpicking. So here is our first boss creature, and this is a whale, and we have to get inside the whale. First we have to shoot him on the outside, and then he opens his mouth, and then when we're inside the whale we just have to shoot him, and then he'll basically break apart. And you have to avoid those water droplets, because if you get hit by them, you die. So that was the first world. That was Auckland, and now we go to Rotorua. And this is where the game already becomes a little bit more difficult. The second boss in this area is, I have not been able to get past it, but you will see that a bit later. The level maps really get more intricate here, and they get a lot more fishy and a lot more vicious. You really have to watch where you're jumping. and especially those well, kind of trumpet things that shoot little bullets, they are really annoying, especially in some places where they go from all sorts of directions. And you see, you'd be thinking, oh, I'm trapped there, but luckily there is a enemy with a hoover pot, and there's pointy spikes that you have to avoid, and this game really likes to put a lot of obstacles in your way, especially those spikes. And yeah, the level maps get really vicious. This version is actually quite a bit easier than the SEGA Master System version, which plays a lot faster. And also, yeah, seems to be a little bit more fiendish. So there's the next Kiwi friend that we've rescued, up to the next stage. And there could be a secret warp zone in this area. I'm not entirely sure. You have to try everything. The best way to discover them is to grab one of those hoover pots and just fly around and shoot like crazy whilst avoiding the enemies. And if you are lucky, you hit one of those warp zones. In some versions of the game, you also have to collect letters. It seems to be a common theme amongst Taito games. For instance, in the Atari ST version, if you collect the letters that form the word extend, you get an extra life. And that is also in the arcade version, and that's something that was carried over from Bubble Bobble. But the NES version doesn't really seem to have it. I don't really know exactly, because those letters are really scarce in the game. You only see them sparingly. They're definitely not in the Master System version. Oh, and that's a fiendish bit of terrain with those pointy spikes everywhere, especially here, because it easily pops your hoverboard or your balloon. Because if you die in certain areas, you will be suspended from some sort of hot air balloon. And now it looks like you're trapped, but you're not, because enemies are appearing. So now we can fly upwards, and remember to hold the button pressed in order to fly. Boom, the hoover thing pops. And isn't that very strategic how they place those enemies and those spikes in relation to those pits? Because those jumps are a little bit tricky, and if you jump too high, if you just press too hard on the jump button, you well, you end up in the spikes with your noggin. So you will, your noggin will be hit by the spikes, and that's very painful. So the game now says to hurry up, and the music also changes, because the levels have a time limit. That's well, kind of typical for a lot of old arcade games, and Taito certainly seemed to have used this a lot, also in Bubble Bobble and in Rainbow Islands. And Ocean Software actually loved to make games with time limits. They've done this in several games, also in the RoboCop games. RoboCop 2 on the NES comes to mind, where you have to collect that nuke stuff. And also RoboCop 3, they really seem to like to put time limits in games as an arbitrary form of creating more difficulty. And those spikes there, they were really vicious. They were just before the end, just before your Kiwi friend. So we are moving on. And now we are going to do a little bit of swimming. And as you've seen earlier, you have a limited supply of oxygen. And in the really long swimming sections, there are areas where you can grab a little bit of air. And that was an extra life, but it wasn't really worth the effort of getting that. Because this area is really vicious too. And as you see now, that was a complete waste of time to grab that extra life. Because this place is littered with spikes to kill you. So that is a bit of risk versus reward, I guess. And just there on top, another little bit of spikes. And this is really tricky because the platforms that you have to jump on are really tiny. And there are spikes everywhere. Oh, another swimming section and some spikes. But this swimming section is luckily very short and not that difficult. But this is rather tricky because now you are in a maze with spikes everywhere. And you have to find the right way, and those bats that are flying there, they are really annoying. And as you see, some enemies just pop up out of the blue. They seem to just appear. And you can't always really predict when they are going to appear. So that's kind of a cheap way of the game to well, make you go game over. Now we have a makeshift hot air balloon. The game does that if there are no enemies appearing. At least not flying enemies. So, how easy does it? And well, every stage is essentially a big maze. And this is a longer underwater section, and you have to watch out for those green things that will grab you. They will essentially suck the life out of you. And here we have a dugout area where we can grab some oxygen. And the meter fills up really slowly. So that was a little splash of oxygen, and there we have our Kiwi friend. Now this next area is insanely hard. Why? Because of all those bullets, and they come out of all sorts of directions. So game over. No, let's continue this bit and I'll show you how hard it is, because I keep dying here and you're just inching forward. You just keep trying a little bit, then you're hit. Well, and then you are respawned on that exact same location. So you proceed for a little bit and then you're hit again. And then you carry on from there. You carry on a little bit further. Oh, it looks like I'm I'm hit again. So frustrating, this bit. And well, that's game over. But the game is generous, as it lets us start in the same place. Because if you would have to restart from the beginning of the level, that would be really cruel. Oh, I guess I'm testing out to see if there's some warp zone here. But I'm not having much luck, and well, yeah, hit again. So we have to go underwater again. And this is a very long swimming section, and the arrows indicate where you have to go. And did you see those spikes? they were all practically hidden. They completely blend in with the background. That is so annoying and so fiendish. So, I guess we're almost at the boss now. And this boss is a variation of the whale boss, but it's a different creature. And I will not be able to beat it as I get easily hit by it. And he's shooting those annoying bats, and they're just hard to avoid. So that was the NES version. Now we're briefly taking a look at the Master System version, and as you can see, it moves a lot faster. The music is really fast, but one thing that really strikes is how much more colorful this version of the game is. The graphics are a lot closer to the arcade, and also quite a bit closer to the Atari ST / Amiga version. Even though this version was not done by Ocean at all, it was done by a by different programmers who did this for Tech Magic, a publisher that did not publish that many games. But yeah, this is an awesome version of the game. Just the colors are very vibrant and eye-popping. And just visually it looks a lot more appealing than the NES version. It's a lot more detailed. One gripe I have with this version is that it's just harder and faster. And of course the music isn't as good. But the visual presentation I think is spot on and well closer to the ST and Amiga. And also a lot closer to the arcade, but believe it or not, there's even a Mega Drive version of the New Zealand Story, but that was only released in Japan, and that version was made by Taito. It's not completely the same as the arcade version, because the Mega Drive version is actually a harder version. It's based on a prototype version of the arcade. When they made the arcade version, they first had different level maps that were a lot harder than the version that they released. So the Mega Drive version is essentially based on a beta version of the arcade. So it's that Hoover capture thing section again. And that's going, well, not so well. But also, this version doesn't really give you extra lives. At least I have not discovered that. It doesn't have any continues, and that is very, well, unfortunate, because that's what makes the game harder, the lack of continues. You have to be really damn good at this game to get any far. And I'm looking for warp zones, but I'm not really sure if I'm gonna find it. Or maybe I'll do, I don't know. I thought I'd captured a bit of a warp zone in this playthrough. The laser weapon is also a lot more deadly. Oh hey, that was the warp zone. And now we are in some, well, strange area that is part of stage 2-1, an area where you normally can't really get to unless you went through that warp zone. I guess it's an alternate way to reach that kiwi. Hey, we got a hot air balloon. I don't think this particular balloon was in the NES version. But this is one of those games that really demonstrates how much better the Master System was at graphics, and especially color. Because that's what really makes this version stand out more. The amount of color and detail. That is 32 simultaneous colors you're looking at. And one of the strengths of the Master System was that it could use more colors per sprite. It could use 16 colors for a single sprite. And that's what makes this version look much more arcade-like. So, this is a second attempt. And as you saw, I went game over pretty quickly. And the NES version in that case would have been really generous, giving you a bunch of continues, but this version doesn't. I'm just trying something out here with the bombs. Well, not that it helps much. I guess picking up the fruit will increase your score. And yes, I'm kind of waiting here because I want to hear that hurry up music theme playing. So, that is stage number two. And I also like those circus advert panels that you see in the background. It's those sort of details that are completely absent from the NES version. Ouch, that was mean. So, we rescued our kiwi friend. There you go. On to stage 1-3. The funny thing is that in the background, where you see the word kiwi, you see a very stylized silhouette version of a real kiwi. That is what an actual kiwi looks like. So for the character, they created a cartoon style chicken, duckling kind of bird, but in the background art they put a real kiwi. So we are almost at our kiwi friend, and navigating through it is already a little bit harder. So that was a look at the SEGA Master System version. As you can see, it looks a lot more like the arcade version, and well, there's a real kiwi again. So there you have it. SEGA Master System version, game over. So that was a look at the New Zealand story for the NES and for the SEGA Master System. In the next video we're going to take a look at Rainbow Islands. I hope you enjoyed it and thanks for watching.